This is Limmer Education's Patient Assessment, A Modern Approach. In this video, we're going to show you an intuitive, easy, and practical way to look at patient assessment. My name is Dan Limmer. We've created a flowchart. We're showing you this two-page flowchart on your screen. You'll be able to download this through a link at the end of the video. You'll see we've taken patient assessment and broken it up into some of the traditional components. What we've done is we've gotten rid of some of the baggage that's come with patient assessment. I've watched Facebook study groups and talked to students who struggle with knowing the difference between terms that might not matter or terms that are outdated, the focused and the rapid exams. In fact, patient assessment should have a flow and be intuitive. And I wanted to show you the whole thing, this two pages. Now I'm going to break it down into parts. I'm going to explain to you what I believe patient assessment should be for you so it's understandable and practical, whether you're talking about the classroom or your practical exam or the street. In this first section, we're going to talk about scene size up. Scene size up, if you put it into a sentence, is big decisions that affect the entire call. You see 1, 2, and 3 across the top of the page. Is the scene safe? If not, call for police. Now, scene size up in safety in a crazy world today, you know, you may come upon somebody who's in a car that's on fire. You may find yourself in a spot where there's violence and bleeding. And if you decide to take a risk, I would just say evaluate the scene carefully and do it wisely. Safety does remain the most important concern, because if you are a patient yourself, you can't help, and you become an extra patient the system has to deal with. Now, 2 and 3 have to do with needing help. Number 2, do you need ALS? Do you need extrication? Is there a fire, hazmat? And number 3, how many patients? If there are multiple patients, you're going to have to call for help and then switch to triage mode. You know, triage mode's a different animal than when you find just one patient at a scene. So those first three I call the operational component of the scene size up, right? You may in class learn, you know, there's so many different decisions. You know, they are decisions, not steps. But there's really two different phases. The first is before you get to the patient, and the next part of the size up is as you approach the patient. Because from the second you get that patient in sight, you're picking up important information. So take a look at the patient as you approach. Before you get there and kneel down and say, "Hi, I'm an EMT, I'm here to help you, what's going on today?" You're gonna look at him and you're gonna see things. Is the patient lying on the ground in front of a car that just struck them, right? Do they have they fallen from a tall building and they might need C-spine? Or is it a medical patient, and as you approach, they don't look very good, they've got poor color and they're in a tripod position trying to breathe. Now what's interesting is that when educators and you listen to videos like this, you know, watch videos like this, we always tend to use the serious patients for examples. But there's going to be times when you get to a patient and they're sitting on a bench in a park and they say, "I think I twisted my ankle, but my wife's going to bring me to urgent care. I'm all set." And that not every patient is serious. That's the nature of this. And quite frankly, as we bridge from the scene size up into the primary assessment, look at those green boxes. Your first look at the patient. Get a general sense of problems and priorities. Because every one of these phases of the patient assessment process prepares you for the next. That's the flow. We often teach these in separate chapters, or we break them up in our head into separate things. But the truth is, those things you observe in the scene size up set a foundation for a call, not only in those operational sections to make sure you've called for the help you need and that it's safe. And by the way, if you don't do those early, we tend to forget or get in the middle of a bad situation we have to deal with. That's really important. But remember, those first observations of the patients lead us to the primary assessment and the next visual on your screen. Primary assessment. Here's the sentence that describes it. What immediate actions are necessary to keep the patient alive? Right? I mean, that's a big thing. Now, again, let's go to the green boxes. Some patients need only minimal assessment and care in the primary assessment. You get a really alert patient and they're telling you what's going on. And while we're going to do some things like, you know, check their pulse quickly and their skin color, temperature, and condition, if they're alert, they're probably not in respiratory failure. the mental status is very, very important. So they're breathing, and yes, they have a pulse. We're going to look at that, of course, a little bit more deeply. So if we go and just look briefly at this section of the ABC, many times we look at the ABC as a linear process. You go from A to B to C, or you do one thing first. But the fact is that what do you do first in the primary assessment? Well, it's the one that's going to kill the patient first. That's why we take pathophysiology as part of an EMT class. You've got somebody that's got arterial bleeding from their radial artery or their femoral artery in their leg, right? They've only got a couple of minutes before they're going to bleed out. Now, if they're also in respiratory failure and have a big trauma and it's just you have to pick one. Well, what's going to kill them first? That bleeding is going to kill them first before hypoxia is going to get them. So we're going to fix the bleeding. So whether you have a patient that's got lots of junk in their airway and they've got gurgling sounds or snoring sounds that need the airway opened, respiratory failure or bleeding, you're going to find patients where there's a lot wrong and you just have to go and do what you have to do, but choose the most important one first. And what's the most important thing? Well, it's the one that's going to kill the patient first. Going back to the main primary assessment screen, remember the AHA says when a patient appears lifeless, use a CAB approach. Now that's important on the street. It's also important for the National Registry exam. The National Registry does pay attention to Heart Association guidelines, and you will get questions when they say you should next. You need to know that. So the lifeless patient, you walk up on a patient and you look, you say to yourself, you get a feeling inside, uh-oh. And they're not moving, their color might be bad. You know, patients that are moving, that's a sign that they're alive. But the ones that aren't moving and just laying there, and as you walk up and start to kneel down, you'll look at their chest and you see their chest isn't moving, right? So we go to the CAB approach. We check the pulse first, and we can look at respirations at the same time. So that's really important. So, transition. How do we get from the primary assessment into the secondary assessment, right? The old way, we looked at mechanism of injury. We looked at things that really don't have an awful lot of play in decision making. That's really not what it's about, right? We want to know how sick is your patient. What's their mental status? What have you had to do so far? They have, you know, cool, moist skin. Are they sick or are they not, right? So in this visual we've given you, it's actually a continuum. Sometimes in the far red side, we got crashing, unstable people. You know, people that just say, oh, I hope they don't code before they get in the ambulance, right? Then there are some when they may look stable, but they've got some time-sensitive issues. Heart attacks and strokes, you know, we have to move them promptly. So on the left side of this continuum, you know, we have to load and go, or at least move them promptly, right? Now, we may want to give some aspirin for the MI patient and do some other things, but that's, you know, prompt. But we also have patients that really aren't as time sensitive, and we're going to spend a little bit more time on scene. So as we transfer into that secondary assessment, what you figure out in your primary assessment isn't just fixing the ABCs, right? You may suction the airway. You may stop bleeding. You know, we don't give oxygen as much as we used to, but our critical patients might get some oxygen, right, if their sats are low or they look really bad. So you've done that stuff, and now you have to say, what next? The primary assessment should give you the information to get there and how sick your patient is. If you're coming out of the primary assessment and you don't know how sick your patient is, you haven't put it all together, right? Oh, they're talking to me. They got a great mental status. They, you know, may have broke the wrist. Broken the wrist. That's fine. It's not so bad. But the patient seems a little drowsy and they got cool, sweaty skin and they don't look good. Right? That's the way we handle our secondary assessment with those patients makes a very big difference. So here's our secondary assessment, right? What do we describe this? What's our sentence to describe this? Perform a history, physical exam, and vital signs to determine what treatments, if any, are appropriate, right? So just a few things in general. You know, there used to be an assessment of the medical patient, assessment of the trauma patient, and we still do things a little bit differently for those patients, but I'm not really sure it has to be broken out that much, right? The medical patient, generally we get more information from the history. That's a good place to start, unless they're unresponsive. And trauma, hands-on physical exam gives us the information. If we feel things that are broken, if we find bleeding, if we find bruising, we find a problem in their chest or their belly, the physical exam makes the difference. And of course, we've learned from the primary assessment that if the patient's serious, we're going to go fast and move the patient more quickly. And if they seem more stable, we might take a little bit more time. But here's the thing. Assess body systems based on the chief complaint. Maybe it's chest discomfort or respiratory distress, abdominal pain. Maybe they fell and they hurt their hip. Whatever it happens to be, we assess body systems based on that complaint. Altered mental status, you may have to assess many body systems. There could be a lot of things doing this. Because here's the thing. As an EMT, you not only have things that you can do to treat conditions, sometimes you have multiple treatments that you can do with a patient complaint. If a patient has an altered mental status, we have naloxone for opiate overdose, we have glucose, and we can also identify stroke scales and cardiac, do the cardiac patients. We have to transport more quickly. So it is important for us to be able to figure out what's going on to do that. Some people say, oh, we don't diagnose. Well, you have to. If you don't come up with what you think it is, you won't know what protocol to apply. So the concept of differential diagnosis says we're going to come up with a list of possible causes and then rule each one in or out with your assessments or history. Think of all the things that can be wrong and you narrow it down. And how do you do that? You examine body systems, the cardiovascular system, respiratory, neuro, musculoskeletal. That's kind of the trauma exam, right? Endocrine, the skin, the belly, and the reproductive, right? And these are sections that are on the National Registry exam. We had vital signs in there, and we come up with a conclusion. I think my chest pain patient has got potential for acute coronary syndrome, where my altered mental status patient has a diabetic history, and the blood glucose monitor says this, or their respirations are shallow to near zero, and I'm going to treat an opiate overdose. You've thought it out. This is not a rote process. This is one of the most important things you do. Most errors in EMS don't come from giving the wrong medication. They come from doing the wrong diagnosis, which leads us to the wrong medication. We don't reach into the drug box and pull out the wrong drug routinely. It can happen. We don't give too much or too little. More frequently, we don't give the right drug because we haven't come to the right diagnosis. And as EMS advances, as EMTs get more and more skills, this is so important. We had vital signs in there. That's important. There are times vital signs will be very significant. Things like increasing intracranial pressure. We'll see the pulse go down and the blood pressure go up. Narrowing pulse pressure, something else that we might find to indicate shock. So then we match the suspected condition with the appropriate protocol to determine treatment. Right? It's funny. It's one sentence in there, but really it shows the value of the assessment. Once you get through the assessment, we have a protocol that's going to give us some guidance in what to do, and you can always call medical direction if necessary to help sort things out. Reassessment sometimes gets just only a little bit of play, but the fact is that there are times that patients become worse and we miss it, and we shouldn't. We have transport times. We have multiple things to do. Sometimes our patients don't seem to change much on the outside, but they're changing on the inside. We need to reassess the patient's complaints, see how we're doing with that. Any treatments that we've provided, make sure things are going well, and continually reassess the vital signs and mental status. The old curriculum said every 5 minutes for a unstable patient and 15 minutes for a stable patient, but the truth is that every 5 minutes is essentially continuously doing vital signs. Conversation with the patient, ask them how they're doing, how their mental status remains. Those things are all vitally important. So we took the sections of the patient assessment process from the scene size up to the primary assessment to the secondary assessment to reassessment and tried to create a positive, intuitive, an easy way for you to think about the patient assessment process. You can download the PDF. Click on your screen to be able to get that. Please feel free to share it with classes or colleagues or fellow students. And as always, you can contact us, support@limmereducation.com. Really, what we do is we try and make EMS easy, understandable, and to help you pass the test. That's what we do here at Limmer Education.